In this video, I will explain how we can use integrals to define new functions. We already know two notions of integral: the definite integral, which is a number, the area under the graph of a function from A to B, and the indefinite integral, which is a collection of antiderivatives. The new concept is the following. We can use the function little f to define a new function big F by this equation. Big F of x is the integral from A to x of f of t dt. Strictly speaking, this is not a new concept. This is, yes, a definite integral, but where the endpoint of the interval is not a fixed constant, but it becomes the variable for a new function. However, I know that the first time one sees this, even though it's in a way the same concept, it becomes a little bit confusing how it relates and how it differs, and in particular why we use the notation that we use. So I want to try to break this down so we understand exactly what we are doing and why we use this notation. And I will begin with a graphic example. I have drawn some axes here. For reasons that I will explain later, I am labeling the axes t and y rather than x and y. And I'm going to be looking at a function which I'm defining via its graph. So this is, in blue, the graph of y equals f of t. And I'm going to put a scale as well. We know how to interpret an integral as area. So for example, this area in green under the graph of the function f from t equals 1 to t equals 2 is what we call the integral from 1 to 2 of f of t dt. I can calculate the integral or the area between any other two values. For example, from 1 to 3, that would be the integral from 1 to 3 of f of t dt. Or the area between 1 and 4 would be the integral from 1 to 4 of f of t dt. And I don't even need to use integers. For example, this would be the integral from 1 to 3.5. And what I'm doing here is I'm fixing the first endpoint, 1, but I'm considering different values for the second endpoint. So I'm looking at the second endpoint of the interval of integration as a variable of a new function. And more specifically, this quantity, the integral from 1 to 2 of f of t dt, I am going to call it big F of 2. And this quantity, the integral from 1 to 3 of f of t dt, I am going to call it big F of 3. And this quantity, the integral from 1 to 4 of f of t dt, I am going to call it big F of 4. And in general, one will always be fixed, but the other endpoint will change. So I'm going to call this arbitrary other endpoint x. Notice the role of x now is different. It's not the variable of integration, it's the other endpoint of the interval of integration. And for each choice of x, I'm going to look at the area between t equals 1 and t equals x. That's the integral from 1 to x of f of t dt. And that's what I'm going to be calling big F of x. And by doing this, I just did a new function. For this choice of x, x is a number, the integral from 1 to x is another number, which I'm calling big F of x. And I can do this in general. This was just one example. So what I am doing is the following. I begin with an interval I, a fixed point a in I. In the previous example, it was 1, and a function f that must be integrable for all of this to make sense. And then, for its value of x, I calculate the integral from a fixed to x of the function little f. And this is a new number that I'm calling big F of x. Okay, for its value of x, I get a new number big F of x. So this is a valid way to define a new function. That's all there is to it. This is how we define a function as an integral, by making the variable of the function be the second endpoint, or it could have been the first, of integration. There is something about this notation that I need to comment on. Notice that I didn't use x as the variable of integration. I used t. Why did I change from x to t? Because x already had a different role, a different meaning in this problem. It was the endpoint. Compare with the following. Let's say we're calculating just a definite integral, the integral from a to b of f of x dx, where a and b are fixed numbers. Well, in that case, we can use any variable we want as the integration variable. The integral from a to b of f of x dx is the same as the integral from a to b of f of t dt. Choose any letter you want. Except, we will never use a or b as the integration variable because they represent something else. So we would never write the integral from a to b of f of a dA. Well, the same thing is happening now. Now I'm defining a function as an integral. Big F of x is the integral from a to x of f of t dt. Little a is now a constant, but x is the variable of my new function. So For the purpose of the integration, I can use any letter I want for the integration variable. Instead of the integral from a to x of f of t dt, I could use the integral from a to x of f of s ds or anything else, except I cannot use a or x because they both already have a meaning. A is a fixed constant and x is the variable of big F. Both are ends of integration. So I can never write big F of x is the integral from a to x of f of x dx. This is really bad notation. Never do this. It's ambiguous. Unfortunately, this abuse of notation sometimes happens, particularly in physics, but it is a bad idea. I recommend you never write this. Technically, it is wrong. To conclude, now that we understand how to use integrals to define new functions, what can we say about them? There is a theorem, the fundamental theorem of calculus, that ties together the notions of definite integral, indefinite integral, and functions defined as integrals. It actually consists of two theorems. It has two separate parts. The first part answers the question, what can we say about a function defined as an integral? So far, all I have said is that this is a valid way to define, to construct a new function. But this theorem will tell us what important property this function always has. And the second part tells us how can we use it to quickly compute definite integrals. For the precise statements of these two theorems and their proofs, keep watching the next few videos.